Hey, this is Calvin Hawkins. You're listening to the Unbelievable Podcast.
There were several groups. One of the principal ones was the reptilians from the Iran complex.
Without any exaggeration, it was like being on fire inside.
Rats were eating you up inside.
This stuff was in my mouth. It felt like it was 500 degrees. It was unbelievably hot.
My first question would be, were you a member of the Church of Satan, a card-carrying member of the Church of Satan?
I don't understand.
There's always an argument for no reason. You know, just because somebody can fake something doesn't necessarily.
We found a life form, and that's when I started shitting my pants.
So for the person who called, I am carrying an alien.
An alien living. We covered right here, okay?
Okay.
Something is happening. What is it? That's the question. So do UFOs exist? It depends on what you mean, exist.
Ghost stories! Spooky tales of spirits who return from the dead to haunt the places they leave behind have been a huge part of the folklore of many different cultures for centuries. From oral traditions and literature to the modern age of films and television, ghost stories remain an important part of our collective entertainment. But what about ghost stories on the radio? Tonight, Spooktober continues for the Unbelievers Podcast as we prepare to dive headfirst into the world of ghost stories. And these aren't just any old ghost stories. These are ghost stories from none other than the legendary host of Coast to Coast AM, Art Bell, and his annual Halloween Open Ghost Lines. So turn down your radio and join us now as we dissect the horror and hilarity of Art Bell and Ghost to Ghost AM. Right here in the program, we continue to learn to unlearn everything you know. Hello and welcome to the Unbelievers Podcast. I'm Rus Ryan.
I'm Drea Mora.
And joining us as always is our soundboard engineer and producer, Rob Okey.
Drop it like a hot rod.
What's up, guys? How you doing?
That's
hello,
a good
Rob.
One.
Hello, Rob. Hello, Drea. And hello, Unbelievers. Spooktober continues tonight because Terror in the Woods, that was only the beginning. And Jack is still in the Terror in the Woods. He couldn't join us tonight.
He kind of left
him in the woods.
He's fine. He's a survivor.
But we have another completely unrelated program of terrifying tales to get into tonight. Are you guys excited?
Yeah.
Hell yeah.
Super.
See, I think I'm extra excited because you two don't know what tonight's topic even is, do you?
No, half the time I would say I don't know what the topic is.
Yeah, most of the time we don't. I mean, sometimes we do. Sometimes we have to do a little homework before, but this week I have no clue what's coming.
No, this week you guys were off. And I have to ask, are you a fan of ghost stories?
Yeah.
I kind of knew that. Now, let me ask you this.
Like, yeah, I have a whole podcast for it.
Are you a fan of radio host of Coast to Coast, Art Bell?
Of course. These questions. Yes.
These are so easy. Well, super. Because tonight, it is time for Art Bell and Ghost to Ghost AM.
Flipping this one final switch, I'm effectively ensuring that I will be extreme prejudice and shot into outer space. I'll be haunting you.
Tonight, we will be discussing one of my favorite traditions of Halloween's past, the annual Coast to Coast AM supernatural extravaganza with Art Bell called Ghost to Ghost AM. And this was a Halloween night open lines for anyone to call in and tell Art Bell a very spooky story. Did either of you ever listen to Ghost AM, the annual show when it would come on?
I'm ashamed to say that I didn't ever listen to a Ghost to Ghost.
No, I've never listened
never
to it.
Have.
I do remember it being mentioned a long time ago by somebody on this show. I can't remember if maybe it was Single 7 or...
I think he said he did call into one. Oh, he might even ended up on this. We don't even know it. I didn't think about that.
Yeah.
But Ghost to Ghost, this has been a part of Coast to Coast since the very beginning. In fact, it played a really big part in morphing Art Bell's political news call-in show from the early 90s into that flagship overnight paranormal show for decades to come. And one of the big reasons for that was the terrifyingly spooky ghost stories that we are going to hear tonight. Are you ready for this?
So ready.
So ready. I'm ready.
Super. We are about to hear
the oldest surviving ghost-to-ghost with Art Bell from October 30th, 1993. This is very early Art Bell. This is around the time of that Area 2000 show that we listened to a few months ago.
Yeah.
How old were you in 1993, Drea? Let's do the math here. How old were we? We were...
somewhere in elementary school. I know that.
Let's see. I think we were like 6 or 7 around that
You're probably
time,
in
maybe?
The back seat in the middle of the night, and this might have been on... But at this time, Coast to Coast was just a political and news show that occasionally veered off into the unbelievable. As you can hear in this intro from Art Bell, and apologies in advance for this blaring background music we're about to hear. It does get better, I swear. Just roll.
Live ghost stories all night long. This is an annual event, and I've got a number of things to say about it. Number one, I take this very seriously. And Halloween is about here. Halloween is tomorrow. And this is as close as we get with this program. And it's going to kind of be a little touch of, I suppose, some of Area 2000. What we do here on special occasions, we every now and then turn away from the news, whatever it happens to be. And it's not much this morning anyway. For now, we're going to delve into a whole different world, and one that I want to warn some of you is going to frighten you. And there are people who become upset by discussions involving the paranormal and ghosts. And if you are one of those people, I urge you right now to turn your radio off. Go watch TV or something. Listen to somebody else's radio program.
Man, I love a disclaimer like that before. It makes you just want to listen more.
Oh,
it's,
yeah.
It's also a way to get out complaints by some very frightened people who just listen to this news show every night. And he's like, by the way, we're going to talk about absolutely terrifying things tonight.
If you're going to be a whiny bitch, don't listen. Just
that is a great disclaimer.
Oh, yeah. No, play soundboard one, that disclaimer. This is for all the weenies out there who think it's scary. I'll say this.
People, I urge you right now to turn your radio off. Go watch TV or something. Listen to somebody else's radio program.
I'm sure the affiliates love that. Like, no. You're supposed to keep them listening to the radio.
Yeah. Oh, I mean, like, he shows with his disgust that you want to not let him down. Like, okay, no, I'm not going to be one of those weenies. I can handle it.
And you can tell he loves that. I think this is really Art coming out as more of that, you know, more wanting to do the paranormal. He's like, look, I am very into, I don't talk about this when I'm talking about the news. You know, he's getting really into it. That character is starting to come out some.
Yeah. But it's a trigger warning. It really is. It's just a trigger warning right off the top.
And
yeah, but
yeah.
This is the best.
Good for
stuff like this, it makes you want to hear more. And before they hit these open ghost to ghost lines, Art can't help but read some news stories. Okay, it's not normal news, though. He does love to read the news. He has spooky news stories, like this one.
This story from the Associated Press, it's Dateline Capitol Hill. With its 200-year history, it's not surprising that the United States Capitol building is the scene of many a ghost story. Clarence Brown, president of the U.S. Capitol Historical Society and a former congressman himself, says over the past two centuries, both the bold and the faint-hearted claim to have seen or heard spirits at the Capitol. There's the story of the demon black cat, reported over the years by more than one guard. There's the sighting of former president-turned-congressman John Quincy Adams, who died near the floor of the old House chamber in 1848. And there are those who smelled baking bread from the Capitol basement long after Union forces ceased using a secret tunnel as a Civil War bakery.
Haunted bread, demon cats, and both of those are more interesting than John Quincy Adams. That was like a snooze of a ghost to have.
Yeah, haunted. I was like... Man. I had to think in my head, like, do I even know what John Quincy Adams looks like in a lineup? Would I be able to tell?
Smell it.
Smell that bread.
News story. That's like a whole podcast. He really blew it there. Just doing it in 1 minute. He could have talked about the bread and wait, what's going on? So bread is a ghost? A smelling bread?
There's a demon cat, too. That's interesting.
Yeah, what makes the cat a demon? Like, come on, it's just a cat. Like, black cats
save this
evil.
For capital strangeness. Maybe next year. No.
Practicing Satanism. Yeah. It was, you know, doing a seance. The demon cat.
Oh, those cats. They're just doing cat
just
things.
The guards. Yeah. The guards see these, and while they're smelling the bread of the haunted subway.
Having a stroke.
In the basement of the Capitol. There.
The secret Civil War bakery. Like, that was just... I didn't know they had secret bakeries.
These are wartime bakeries. These were serious bakeries. A lot of people died in those bakeries.
No fun time bread.
I'm getting hungry. You guys are making me hungry right now. I need like a muffin.
Honestly, that would
smell
really good. I just want
some ghost muffin would be delicious right now, I think.
Mm.
Well, if you thought that the Capitol story was fascinating and made you hungry, check out this story from where does the next news story come from anyway, Art Bell?
It comes from a newspaper that you probably don't read. It's a little newspaper called the Gateway Gazette, and it's entitled The Ghosts of the Mizpah Hotel. About 2 months ago, I bellied up to the bar at one of my favorite watering holes, the Mizpah Hotel Casino in Tonopah. My son had come up from Las Vegas to visit, and we were having a late-night drink. It was about 1 in the morning. You see, about 1 in the morning. These are the times, ladies and gentlemen, where these things occur. A fellow, I would guess to be in his 40s, came up from behind us, sat at the bar next to me. I glanced at him, seeing a dozen or two tattoos on his arm, decided to avoid a conversation. I heard him order a beer. When the beer arrived, he upended the bottle, guzzled down a slug. The bottle hit the bar with a whack, and he looked at me and said, "Boy, that's a hell of a hologram they've got in the elevator." Huh?
What? Oh.
Hologram.
Huh? Yes, okay. This is the elevator hologram ghost.
A hologram.
It's not a hologram.
It's a hologram.
It's a hologram.
I thought for a second the tattoo guy was going to be the ghost, but no.
Yeah, no. And yeah, Art, play soundboard too, because as soon as Art hears there's a hologram, he's like,
huh?
I don't know why I found that so funny. It's so isolated.
It is great. He's not normally at a loss for words. You know, he's usually has something witty to say. So it is. That is funny. So
I didn't like that,
again?
Though. I mean, I don't even have any tattoos, but I'm offended. They're being a real Judge Judy.
It's 1993,
here,
you know, Rob. Like, tattoos meant something then. You were a little tougher then.
I get it. This guy's supposed to be like, his name is Spike, and he's like, he drives
Butch,
a motorcycle.
He's down on his luck.
Yeah, he's unpredictable, but he's real crazy, and he's got tattoos on his arms. I get it. He painted a great picture of that.
Yeah, and he drinks beer.
He drinks beer. He slugs it.
Tough. And he takes elevators. This place he's at is called the Mizpah Base Hotel and Casino, and this bar patron is there. He's slamming drinks and he's telling people how impressed he is with that hologram that he saw in the elevator. Rob, you're a tech guy. Have you ever seen a hologram in an elevator?
Let me think. No.
Maybe once. No.
I mean, I've seen some weird shit in elevators, but I don't think I've seen any holograms.
I've seen literal shit in elevators.
It's very sci-fi. That's like some of the Star Wars hotel would have. This is 1993. You got to keep his ear. And now the Mizpah Base Hotel and Casino. I'll stop. Let's hear about this hologram.
Huh? The elevator, he said. I've never been there before. They've got an incredible hologram in there. I don't understand. He said, I thought you were a local. The Mizpah has a hologram of a beautiful woman dressed in old-fashioned clothing. It's in the elevator, man. It does look real. I told him that I'm a local. I also asked him, there's no hologram in the elevator. He looked at me strangely, drank his beer, and left. A few minutes later, he returned to the bar. He looked upset. "You're right," he exclaimed. "There is nothing in the elevator." He walked back toward the elevator, and I never saw him again. Had the lady in red appeared again? There are many strange tales from the hallowed ween halls of the Mizpah. The most popular tale involves the murder of a pretty young lady on the fifth floor of the hotel. She was a lady of the evening and became involved in a love triangle.
So there is a beautiful hologram with period clothes. It kind of looks like a hologram. How many drinks does this guy have? Hold on, this guy was hanging out. How many drinks does he have before he's seeing holograms?
About that hologram.
I mean, well, whatever. However many drinks he had beforehand, I guess that one beer reset it because he didn't see it after that.
I take back what I said before, too. I have seen a hologram inside of an elevator.
Son
of
a bitch.
It was in Disney World, the Haunted Mansion. I'm pretty sure that there are holograms. Maybe this happened. I know they said it was a mitzvah.
That's stretching paintings.
This could have been in Disney World at the Haunted Mansion, though.
This isn't Disney World, though. Place number three, this Mizpah Base Hotel Casino. Man, this really is a prophetic esplanade. It has these.
The hallowed ween halls of the Mizpah.
Hallowed ween halls.
With ween in them.
What is a ween hall?
I don't know.
The band Ween.
Oh.
I think it's more likely they got trash bags. It looks like, on the walls, like a haunted house, these hallowed ween halls.
Yeah.
The Mizpah Base Hotel. So, do you guys want to hear more about this lady in red hologram ghost from the Mizpah Base Hotel and Casino?
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
Fine.
She was caught with another man by the man who was madly in love with her. He stabbed her to death. There have been many sightings of the lady in red. She resides on the fifth floor, but she'll wander all over the hotel. She loves to pull pranks. The one that causes the Kino board to light up. Wait till you hear this. Many employees and visitors to the Mizpah claim they've seen the Kino board begin to flash numbers as if a game were in progress. The Kino boards at the Mizpah haven't been connected to an electrical source for years. Many claim she can be heard at night, moaning and walking about the floors. Oh. She's been known to carry on a conversation with people. We'll only later find out no one is there.
Huh. Yeah, the lady in red, man, stabbed to death, and now a Kino board operating, elevator riding hologram. It's a good ghost story.
Yeah, she sounds fun. That's something that I kind of do want to happen. Like, I'm really terrified about the idea of seeing a full-bodied apparition, but if it's one of those ghosts where you swear you're just talking to a person and you have a conversation.
Oh, that would be the coolest.
That would be so cool.
I want that to happen.
I want to go
to the Mizpah Bays now. I want to play Ghost Kino. I want to have some pranks. That sounds fun. And moaning, that's kind of fun, too.
That's kind of fun, too.
Yeah. It could go without the moaning. The moaning,
Roth doesn't like moaning.
It could be a little off-putting after a while.
After a while? Well, we don't know how long she's moaning for, but yeah, it would be creepy. It would.
Enough for them to mention it here, so I think it's a reoccurring thing. She needs to just, literalize.
She's going
to
settle down
if you're there. Tylenol or something.
But I have a question for Art Bell, though. How do you know that this Kino board isn't hooked to an electrical source?
I don't know if I don't know for a fact that the Kino board isn't connected to an electrical source, so I can't really say that the lady in red is involved. Who knows? Maybe they left a wire or two connected to some source by accident. Dennis says she's heard that the lady in red will steal guests' shoes, but only if the shoes are red.
Oh, don't change the subject. We're not talking about shoes here. Worried about the Kino board. Art seemed to get real defensive. No one was interrogating him. That was pretend.
I don't even know what a Kino board looks like. I'm trying to imagine.
A Kino board is like a giant board of just like a series of numbers. Like it's either 1 through 100 or 1 through 50.
Okay.
And they flash up. It's like a giant kind of bingo looking board.
Okay. Yeah, I was about to say bingo. I get it confused with bingo, but
something like that.
Yeah. Well, I mean, like it is interesting that something could still have some kind of spark of electricity to it for things to like light up and stuff. Like, you hear stories about toys somehow being activated when no one's
like
near
ghost
them.
Truck. Christmas is coming. I might get the ghost truck story out this year.
Yes, exactly. And some people say like, oh, it's just, faulty wiring. So if it's not connected, though, to anything, like if there's no batteries in it, whatever, like that, I don't know. To me, that's kind of proof.
That's unexplained. That's like last week with the telephone ringing on its own. It's just, that just doesn't physically, it shouldn't happen. So if someone's able to prove that that's happening, I think
that's part of Spooktober,
really,
man.
Strong evidence.
These random electrical objects who we don't know how they're just working on their own.
Yeah.
Wait till Christmas, that ghost truck. I swear I'll get it. This lady in red, this is a very busy ghost in the Mizpah Base Hotel and Casino because she's also a bit of a groupie.
He also tells the story of a band that had been contracted by the Mizpah. They heard stories about the lady in red decided to hold a party in their room. During the party, they began asking for her, a sort of seance. The lady not only appeared to them, but bothered them for the rest of the week. She wouldn't leave them alone.
Man, that's the worst kind of groupie. Is it an annoying one you can't get rid of now? What is this, Jimmy Page or somebody from Rock and Roll Conspiracy?
She just wants out of there. I don't blame her. But Yeah, that is definitely annoying if someone overstays their welcome like that.
A clinger, a real Klingon, you know
that,
what I mean?
That is the whole groupie arc that they go through. Where they eventually get, thrown off the bus, out of the base casino.
They get ditched at the 7-Eleven.
Yeah, these stories, those are just to set the mood for what is to come once Art Bell unleashes his ghost-to-ghost open lines on the unsuspecting listenership that think they're listening to news. But before that, we get what I feel is the definitive Art Bell statement on his search for something more.
We're going to talk about ghosts, poltergeists, spirits. And one of the reasons that I've found this topic through my life so fascinating, and I always return to it, is because for a very long time I've been on a search, a hard search, or some sort of proof of life after death.
Yeah, you and me both. It is a big question we want to know. And the way he presents that, man, I believe him that this was his passion that led him into just going full on paranormal.
Oh yeah, totally. I mean, that's kind of where I'm at. You know, that's what I would want to be doing too. If I had that kind of scope and listenership and people to ask stories from and everything and proof, like,
You
kind of really
already do
venue.
So you're doing okay.
You can kind of feel Art having like an existential moment right there, you know, being like,
I must find the answers to the truth.
Find the what is after life, like if there is anything, what happens?
Time.
Yeah.
It's only 1993. There's a lot of stuff to come. We'll figure it out. But enough setup. It is time for Ghost to Ghost AM. Let's go to the first time caller line.
Morning, first time caller line, you're on the air. Where are you calling from?
Morning, from Alameda, California, outside of San Francisco.
Oh, excellent. Welcome to the program.
Sorrow. Last year, my five children and I, we live in a big, old, rambling house, and I started hearing things, but I thought it was the children. The house is so big that you might hear from the next room. With five kids, anybody could be anywhere in the house.
Absolutely.
And I'd go, and the door slammed too hard, so I'd go to reprimand, don't be slamming the door, and there was no one there. So, of course, your mind tells you, I thought I heard something, oh, well. And so then you'd hear footsteps, and you think someone's coming downstairs, and you'd go, and, oh, I thought I heard something, oh, well. Well, unbeknownst to me, the children were experiencing noises and footsteps, and I didn't want to tell them because I wasn't sure what it was, and I dismissed it from my mind. And then when I started saying, no, this is something, I didn't want to scare them. And apparently they were experiencing all this as well, people going into the shower, someone entering the shower when they were in the shower.
That would bother me.
Oh, that's very unnerving.
Yeah, this lady, the shower ghost story. I mean, and she's like, I thought I heard something. Oh, well, she kept saying that over and over. I don't know. She sounds too good to be true, man. I don't know if this is a good call or just an act.
I don't know. I mean, I think because of the way she sounded, kind of, for lack of a better term, she kind of sounds goofy in her storytelling. It seems genuine to me. Like, oh, well, like,
so they sound like before. Yeah, she does sound like she's told this story before. She kept saying,
I thought I heard something. Oh, well.
And then she said it again, exactly the same. Almost sounded like she sound clipped herself so she could play it.
I could have clipped it twice. It sounded exactly the same. I just picked the cleanest one. Yeah. Let's hear more about the shower ghost and the great first time caller line lady.
Suddenly be in the shower soaping up and feel the brush of another body next to you.
Real sensation of something or somebody, and you quickly look out the curtain and no one's there. You quickly lather off and hear say, but I know I did. But here again, I guess it's my mind.
Well,
everyone was experiencing these things, but no one told anybody. I didn't, for the specific purpose. I didn't want to scare the children. They didn't tell me, thinking, as a child think, that if they told me, it would come true.
Right.
The one day that we found out that everybody knew was when I was reprimanding my son, and he was very distracted and agitated, and I thought he was being disrespectful. So as I started to correct him even more, he finally said, no, Mom, it's not you. I saw something. And that's when the flood of everybody, yes, I saw it too, and I heard this, and saw that, and I saw, I mean, you would hear someone jumping on the bed, and I'd go to look, and nobody was there.
Oh, well.
There's a lot of strangeness and a lot of reprimanding going on in this house. It's like, I can't tell if this lady is crazy or not. What are your thoughts, Drea?
She seems like very nice and like straight-laced, like maybe probably made her kids go to Sunday school and everything, but well-meaning. Because she seems very, very polite in the way she's speaking with Art Bell. And I don't think she's crazy. I think she's
I think Rob's getting a little scared here in this. I think Rob, this is sounding a little Enfield horror-ish or something.
A little bit. Really. There is like a movie quality to it, the way that like the whole family was like, oh shit, I saw it too. And the little kids were like, we saw that shit, same thing. It's so crazy.
Isn't it sexy too? That they're lathering up in the shower.
That's the weirdest part. That's the weirdest part. All right,
you have to hurry up. If the ghost starts rubbing you in the shower, all right, you got to lather off real quick. You got to get out of there.
At this point, finish the shower and enjoy it.
At this point, I'll take it. But that would be weird. It would be weird if you were in the shower and then all of a sudden a ghost just came in there with you and started hogging up all the water. And you know,
what I mean? Yeah, like, that's the worst.
That would be like, it's like, get out of here. What are you doing? Wait till later.
Hey, Art's loving this.
Yeah.
This is an action-packed call from the shower touching lady.
Another night I was home alone and I was very agitated and I couldn't read, I couldn't sit down, I couldn't watch TV. And so finally I sat down and looked at a picture book, one of the children's picture books, and I had this overwhelming sense that someone was looking at me. Mm-hmm. When they came home, they saw two footprints of mud, and my son put his feet in there, and the angle that it was, whatever it was staring at me. That's why I was so agitated. So these things just started accelerating. When the thing found out that we knew, it started manifesting itself in the form of a shadow. And I'm talking about at 12 noontime. The children saw it first, and they became crumpled. They were crumpled, absolutely. I mean, they were yelling crumpled? And screaming. And
I'd be crumpled, too.
Oh, my God.
Crumpled. I think I'm crumpled now, too. What the hell is going on here? What is this lady talking about?
You've never seen a ghost and just crumple immediately into a ball on the floor?
Nobody saw ghosts. They saw some muddy footprints that no one wanted to claim
and
in their house.
Shadow.
They were aimed right at you. It was like,
it almost sounds like a British, like, phrase, like, oh, the children were crumpled, you know, like, it just like,
are you thinking of crumpets?
Yeah, that's what it did remind me of, was crumpets. It did make me, right. Once again, I'm hungry.
Well, play soundboard five. If you thought you were alone and being crumpled by this, you are not, because
I'd be crumpled too.
Thank you, Art Bell.
He loved it. He loved that line.
This is great. This is what Ghost to Ghost is all about. This is one of the very first ones. And this terrifying call, it goes on some more.
So I called my priest. I went up and we right away got in the van and went up there and told him. And he didn't believe us. He said there were mice or, you know, people, hysteria, and all the common explanations that you get. I was so upset that on the way home I ran a stop sign. I knew that we saw and we heard what we saw and we heard. Finally, till that night, I saw the shadow. And I bolted up. We were all sleeping now together. We all had to touch each other. Everybody, six people in a room, everybody's feet or something had to be touching. We were so scared.
I do understand, yes.
I didn't want to tell anybody with the reaction of the priest that it wasn't true. I thought we'd be labeled as either liars or...
Did the priest come there?
That was uncomfortable.
I don't know. What do you think, Art? Is this for? This is going so off the rails. Everyone starts touching each other. They touch all the babies. The priest is going to come there.
What I wound up doing is that I wound up touching all the babies.
Oh, man. You know what I would have said if I was in that bed? I would have been like,
don't touch me. Don't get your hands off me.
Yeah, well, play soundboard six, because she is adamant about one thing throughout this.
That we saw and we heard what we saw and we heard.
Amen, lady.
Yeah,
totally.
I mean, that's
look, Rob's brave enough to not need to.
How did everyone end up in bed together? Hold on, this turned into like, did you hear? That's like a Willy Wonka situation going on with Grandpa Joe. They're all like, somehow they're all in a bed together.
All of a sudden they got a giant-sized bed. How did they do that?
And Art's like, oh, yeah, everybody's touching me. I'm into this. Firstly, we're all showering, rubbing down. Now everyone's in bed.
Yeah, don't do that. Don't do that. Sleep in separate beds, please. I'm uncomfortable just thinking about it.
All right, that first call was kind of all over the place. It's time to move on, though, to the next call in for Ghost to Ghost.
Well, I have a story for you that will probably won't send goosebumps up your spine. It'll probably make you go, oh, isn't that sweet, if that's possible. I had an aunt that I was very, very close to, actually a great aunt. Always kind of looked up to her in life. She was kind of my...
Sure, mentor.
My mentor, thanks. And I had gone out to the cemetery, as I do once a month, to put flowers on her grave and kind of trim the grass and all that.
Right.
And as I was driving around the curb, she ran out in front of my car, and I thought, no, I'm seeing things, but when somebody something runs out in front of your car, what do? You slam
on the brakes.
I got rear-ended by two other cars, one of them being the security guard at the cemetery. I jumped out of the car thinking, oh my God, I'm going to pay for this one through the nose. Went back to make sure the people in the other two cars were okay, and both of them said, well, that woman shouldn't have run out in front of you like that. And I said, well, you saw her too? And they said, of course we saw her. And I said, well, I don't really remember what she looked like. I knew what she looked like, but, you know, I wanted to check things out.
Mm. What do you mean? Well, check what out? What is this guy even talking about? I'm definitely not saying, oh, this is sweet. I'm like, what the hell is he saying? Does he say his dead aunt ran out in the middle of the road like a maniac?
Yes, and which is still weird, but yeah, he's doing that whole thing.
It caused an
like...
accident. There was no accident going to happen. A bunch of the PD from Bachelor's Grove was driving his car behind him and ran into him. Is that what he said? Like cemetery employees are ramming into his car now.
Yeah, the security.
Did sound
why were
like
they
that.
All on the line like that? Yeah, that is really weird that it's one thing to have like your someone's ghost manifest, but like that's such a weird way to have that happen.
Yeah,
like
it's a jump scare. It's a jump scare. She ran out of the road. If my dead aunt run out in the road in front of me. I know we've been talking about aunts and uncles a lot lately. But
I don't know if do you think insurance would cover that? Like I know
no.
sometimes they cover deer collisions and that kind of stuff. Do you think they
well,
cover?
Well, hey, I will say maybe
ants?
It will because all that the people behind him didn't know that it was just a ghost. They saw a person run into the road. So yeah, I think it would stand.
Well, that's the
really?
Other thing I'm saying. They saw the thing run out in the road. There's a woman. Let's just say a woman ran out in a road. And maybe it was his aunt. Maybe he's just tripping because he just went to the cemetery once a month to go put the flowers. He's thinking about his aunt.
Man.
A lady runs out. Is that my aunt? Oh, no. And everyone's like, yeah, we saw that lady, too. That was not your aunt. Like,
she's
your aunt
a runner. She's a track star. Fucking, can you imagine? What does it look like when someone's aunt is just running around the cemetery? What
and
is
then
that?
Does she disappear after? Like, did she keep running? There's so many questions I still have.
Yes, yeah, there are a lot go? Of questions, Trey. You're right. And this guy has more to say about his relationship with his dead aunt.
A year after that, I went to the cemetery, drove down the hill, went around the corner, and the same exact thing happened again, and I was rear-ended.
You're wrong. This
another
is,
car.
You're wrong, sir. This is a goosebump story.
They saw the same person, and I guess the point that I'm getting at is I see my aunt all the time. I see her when I'm in town. I don't know if it's somebody that looks like her. But I just feel that she has a lot to do with the things that have been happening in my life. I feel like she's always
do you
there
tend,
guiding
do you,
me.
Yeah, do you tend to see her at critical junctures in your life?
You know, that's funny you should say that. A month ago I was in the hospital facing major surgery, and the door opened one night, and she came in and sat on the bed, took my hand and said, the doctors are wrong. They've misdiagnosed you. You need to tell them that. The next morning, I asked the doctor to rerun tests because I felt something wasn't right. And sure enough, the tests had come out wrong, and I didn't need surgery. So,
oh, man. All right, sir. I've got to run. We're out of time. But believe me, that's a prime.
Your watch. She's there, and she's taking care of me. So I have a good guardian angel.
Thank you for the call. My gosh, what a story. Didn't mean to cut you off, but we're out of time.
He did. You knew.
So
meant
to cut you off.
Definitely yeah. did. And I'm on the fence. Drea, is this a goosebump story?
I'm not a goosebumps expert. I don't remember all of them. I feel like so many of the goosebumps stories that I read were so fucking weird that this would be the least weird one. But I mean, yeah, probably. He didn't sound believable. He sounds exactly like all the other callers that I talk shit on.
He sounds like a guy who's fixated on his aunt. And I like that the aunt knows more than the doctors do. It's like, no,
yeah.
Hold on.
You know,
let me
sounds like? Who he really sounds like?
This is really kind of like too unbelievable for me.
Thank
That's
you,
what he
Rob.
Sounds like.
Exactly.
He does. And he might be very, very lonely and miss his aunt because he is calling it to Coast AM in 1993. It's not even just a paranormal, just a news show. And I don't know, even I had better things to do back then. You guys were kids, definitely, and you were doing better things. So maybe the next caller can elevate the level of spookiness on Ghost to Ghost. Here is a lady who is having unbelievable experiences with mirrors.
During 1970, I was visited in my mirror by my father, my biological father, who I did not know was deceased.
That would scare me to death. That might scare me to death. To look in a mirror, I hear stories like these, ma'am, and that would really fright me. How solid did the vision seem to be?
Well, the first thing was, it was a new home, and we had just bought this new bedroom set and set it up and everything, and my husband was away a lot. He was all of a sudden, just out of a clear blue sky, I woke up, and I saw this strange light. It was like light in the mirror.
Mm-hmm.
And it got brighter and brighter and brighter, and I got scared. I really did.
I understand.
And all of a sudden, it just like it came out of the mirror, and there was my biological father. I had not seen him since I was
old. Wait a minute. It came out of the mirror?
Out of the mirror.
In a solid form?
In a solid form.
Whoa. Mm. Yeah, Art seemed very thrown off by the mirror revelation there.
That's trippy. Mostly because she took forever to get there. He's like, how solid? Well, so we got a new bedroom set. Like, just say how
right.
solid it was.
Bedroom set.
That's a lot of details go in a lot of these calls. I don't know why they feel like they have to feel, you know, really express these stories these way. But yeah, I don't know. Yeah, play 747. I like when Art is thrown off by the mirror. He says this.
Wait a minute. It came out of the mirror?
Out of the mirror.
In a solid form?
In a solid form.
Whoa. I agree with that. That's crazy. I mean, I'd be shocked too. That takes the whole story to the next level.
It's her biological father coming to her. And I guess there's some kind of separation here. I think she hasn't seen him since 3 years old. And she gets to see him. And says, hey, that's more than I got from mine. So that's kind of interesting.
Dark.
I mean, I know. I didn't even put that together for a second. I'm like, oh, okay. Yeah. I mean, that's I don't know. Did she say how long it had been since she'd seen her father?
I think she said she was three. She did say, she remembered a little bit from her dad. So.
That's so crazy. I wonder if he showed up in the way that she remembered seeing him. Like,
yeah,
right,
how does that work?
Then, or like, how
is he older? Is he aged? Like,
it was like that aha video. What happened with this lady? Definitely. With her. It was her dad, though.
Oh, yeah. And then he pulls her into a comic book world. Like, that's great.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know how I feel about this one. Just like Art.
It would scare the shit out of me.
I want to know more about what happened after he came out of that mirror.
Look, I'm not sure how, but somehow this call about your dad who stepped out for cigarettes one night and he ends up later stumbling through your mirror. this story caused Art to both question and instantly answer his question a record 6 times in a row.
Do you believe that, lady? I do. Do you believe these stories? I do. Do you understand what it means? I think I do. Is there life after this one? I think there is. Are these things we don't understand? They certainly are. Are they a little frightening? They absolutely are.
Do I enjoy Art Bell? I do. Is some of it a little silly? It is. Will I clip it and laugh at it? Yeah.
Yes.
Does that make me a bad guy? No. Do other things make me a bad guy? Maybe. Is Spooktober the spookiest month? I think so. Do you guys have any questions for yourself before we move
on? I think you've answered every question that I could think of, and Art Bell has as well. That's 12 questions answered. I'm good.
That's a great bit to do. I got to remember to ask and answer my own questions. Like, it'll roll a lot. Like, it's a very, very fun device.
I do.
I think I do.
Well, that's how you move on from a lady like that. So next up is a man on Ghost to Ghost AM, a man from Nevada. And he doesn't give his name, but he has this to say.
I'm a recovering alcoholic, and I was going out with a girl who had just got into recovery, and we were in counseling, and we were doing a bunch of inner child work. One of the reasons we got along so well, our therapist says, because we played so well together. Anyway, so one night, I'm laying in my bed, and in this therapy work that we're doing with inner child, you have to close your eyes and imagine this child, and you know, what that child was doing at the time. And I was laying in my bed and my eyes were open, and all of a sudden this little girl, about 8 years old, she had a pixie haircut and kind of a, she was wearing shorts and a small halter top, came up, and she was standing right next to my bed, and my eyes were wide open. And it was that my girlfriend is like, you know, a smaller version of her, right? And
yes.
And this girl, without opening her lips or anything, said, you know, to me, "I've come to play with Chris," who was like, and that's my name and my inner child. So,
okay, sir, this is a fun and spooky ghost call-in show. Now, whatever the hell this pedo fantasy is playing out on Coast to Coast. I've never heard of something called child regression therapy that makes you see your girlfriend as an 8-year-old in a halter top. Do you guys know about this?
Oh, God. Not quite to that extent. Like, it's usually just you and yourself, and that's usually the extent of it. Like, what?
If this was supposed to actually like send shivers up your spine, congratulations, dude. This is actually like
for
upset
the wrong
me here.
Reasons.
I'm like, whoa, and weird. Just kept escalating and escalating.
Really weird. Really, really, really weird.
Why is this on here though? Is his little girlfriend now a ghost? His 8-year-old girlfriend in a halter top? Where is this going? Let's hear.
This little girl is standing there, and she's talking to me. She says, "And I'm leaving. I'm moving. And I wanted to come and play." And so she starts taking off with this other little kid. I'm assuming it was me. And they're running. And all of a sudden, then I don't see walls in my room or anything. I just see them out like in a field running.
Wow.
And I keep saying out loud to this girl who I had since not dated, "Gary, do you feel this?" I was wondering if there was a connection between her and me.
Right.
And I kept saying, do you feel this? Are you here? Do you are you seeing what I'm seeing?" And then the little girl walked back up and said thank you and that she was leaving. And I was telling her, I said, "You can come back anytime you want." It's not a fear thing. I was not afraid.
Why not?
Well, because she was...
I guess because it was somebody you knew, somebody you know.
Right, I think so. And she was just... You know, 8 years old, 9 years old, and just real shy, and you know.
I would like to think I could react as you did. I'm going to have to leave the line because we're out of time. I thank you for the call. I would like to think that I would react that way.
Okay, thank you, Art. How dare this guy smut up the Halloween halls of ghost to ghost? I do not like this. Is this even a ghost story, Drea?
No, it's not a ghost story at all. It's like I've heard stories where people confuse like ghosts with things like ghosts of somebody who's still alive. So it's like, I don't know, astral projecting. But even so, if it's like the kid version of something, like, no. And I was trying not to get the obvious creeped out vibe. I'm like, no, I'm going to give him benefit of
the
doubt.
He pushes that button the entire time, though.
Dude, the last time that I had that feeling of like, no, I'm going to give the benefit of the doubt was the Stan Romanek fucking documentary. So I was like, nah, this feels gross. It feels weird. It's creepy.
Well, this is 1993. Reasons. This guy's probably dead or harmless at this point. So I think we're okay.
It's really strange,
he never made him much.
You know, Kathleen Roberts does channel living people, though. So maybe he's doing a similar thing while he's sleeping. He's channeling.
Not this is
you shouldn't
weird.
Be able to channel living people.
I know.
What
it's
he's
weird.
Talking
it's,
about.
Listen, I know it's weird. But just open your mind a little bit. Think about it.
Okay.
And... I don't know. They're more having like, it's not a ghost experience. It's like an eternal sunshine of the spotless mind experience.
Yeah,
where like,
yeah.
They're like, for whatever reason, I don't know what the point of this
or
is.
Or that time travel movie Brian talked about where he met his girlfriend when she was like his
oh,
wife.
Oh, God, I
when
forgot
she was
about that. Yeah,
the time traveler, that movie.
Time traveler.
Yeah. It does sound
yeah,
like that.
I did watch
but
that
he,
movie. It's weird. Very strange.
He's like, no, it's not weird. It's just my girlfriend. And she's
like,
little
nope,
now. Yeah,
still
no.
Weird.
Get off my ghost line. I wish he would have said that.
That'd be great, but I think he was glad to have people. This was the first ghost line, so probably was a little bit more patient.
I think he just wanted to talk about 8-year-olds in halter tops. I think he just wanted to get on radio and say that because he's a weirdo and a creep. And if you thought
secret to get out, yeah.
If you thought that would be the most upsetting call of the evening, I'll stop you right there. Let's take this from bad to worst.
Good morning, first time caller line. You're on the air.
Good morning, Art Bell.
Yes, where are you calling from?
This is Pavo.
Pavo in Canada. Yes, you have something that relates to all this, Pavo?
Yes, I do.
That's amazing. All right, let's hear it.
Usually, people that enter in
to my domain receive an eerie feeling when they see all of the murals and...
I can only imagine what your area looks like, Bob.
But there's one room in my house that is a shrine to you-know-who.
Hitler.
Yes.
What? Cool. Okay, so you thought ghosts would give you dang old creeps, huh? How about Hitler?
I'm sorry, what? He like, I can only
Hitler.
Guess who. Hitler, yep.
Oh, like, Hitler, that guy will give you the willies, Hitler. And yeah, place number 9. Whoever refers to Hitler as you-know-who. I've never heard that.
To you-know-who.
Hitler.
Yes.
Yes, I feel course. Like Art has dealt with this guy before. Yes,
he has.
Right?
He
I was like, did he get briefed? Like, I can only imagine what your area looks like. Is it Hitler?
Greatest guess in the world if he hasn't met this guy before.
No, he definitely knows this from his political call-in show. This is a guy named Pavo. Pavo from Canada. Creepy Canada, may I add. And has he given you the dang old creeps yet, Drea?
Yeah. I don't like the way he talks. I don't like his cadence. It's just,
good. Because you're going to hear some more now. Let's hear some more Pavo.
When you walk in, the presence is so strong that the power, you feel the power.
Thank you, Pavo. That is Pavo, who is in Canada. He's up in the Edmonton area, I believe. And Pavo is a Nazi. He really is a Nazi.
Okay.
And he was talking about what he does now. And his shrine, I don't have to be there to imagine what it is like. And I can easily imagine that it imparts the exact feeling that he was just talking about. Eerie.
Very eerie. Yeah, of course.
Eerie.
Oh, so he's a Nazi. I guess that certainly explains the Hitler shrine. I don't know. I thought he might be a big History Channel fanboy. This is 1993. And Canada had a lot of Nazi guys in 1993. Maybe it's just like all of them were flooding into talk radio, Art Bell in the 90s.
It's just super, super fucking weird thing to call in for a spooky ghost line thing. It's like,
you
didn't mention any ghosts. You just want to talk about Hitler more.
This is not a Nazi flex line. I don't know what the fuck you think this is, dude. Like, get out of here. Who invited
exactly.
you? Who invited
like,
you
oh,
to this show? What
it's so
the fuck?
Spooky
ghost
that
ghost.
I like Hitler.
Ghost to Ghost is going completely off the rails from the beginning. These calls were following.
If you are a Nazi, and only if you are a Nazi.
We've heard spirit children, girlfriends. Now we got Hitler. We got Nazis. Please, next caller, let's talk about ghosts.
Yeah, good morning. My name's John. I'm from, I'm in Sparks. I've been listening to your show on spooks and goblins here. And let me turn down this radio.
No, just actually turn it off all the way. Just extinguish it.
There, it's out.
Right.
And I got an interesting story. My ex-wife used to dabble with Ouija boards and what have you, and we were horsing around with it one night. The following weekend, I'd gone out fishing with a friend of mine and came back later that evening, and we watched TV for a while, and then we went to bed, and the back door of the house and the front door of the house were in line with each other, and our bedroom was at the other end of the house.
Right.
Hey, who cares?
And I was just dozing off. And I swore I heard the back door open, and somebody in heavy boots closed the door and walked through my kitchen.
Mm-hmm.
I went to my dresser drawer, and I grabbed my 9mm, and I took it out, and I'm standing in the hallway thinking, God, I hope I don't have to do this.
God, please, dear God, do not force me to shoot this ghost or this Ouija board. Yeah, we got a real action flick going on now. A Dirty Harry of Ouija.
Yeah, he's so tough. He's like, God, I hope I don't have to use this for the ghost.
Don't make me grab the 9mm. Shit. He's got to come out and bust a cap in his ass.
It's the same ghost from earlier, too. It's got the boots. He heard heavy boots. We heard boot prints earlier. It's the same ghost that's going
around. Yeah, man, all ghosts wear boots.
So, yeah, you want to hear how this action flick's going to go down? How Dirty Harry here is going to deal with this midnight intruder?
Yeah, man, I'm invested.
All right, fine.
I got locked and loaded, and I swung out into the hallway, and there was just enough residual light in the living room. I could see the silhouette of this individual, about 6'3", pretty stocky person. And I uttered some explicitives to lead it and told him to freeze right where he was or I was going to dump him. And you remember the old window shades where you take and you pull them down, you let them go, and they just go up and spin around?
Very well, yes.
Yeah, well, that's exactly what happened to this silhouette.
Oh, you're...
Straight up.
Really? Just like a window?
Just like the old window shades. It just went straight up and vanished. And that was a very puckering experience, if you know what I mean.
I know what you mean.
And I'll never forget it. That we had other interesting happenings in that house, too. We had clocks that would mysteriously just slide off the shelf and drop onto the floor for no reason at all.
Well, this has been sphincter tightening enough for me.
Yeah.
Really?
Yes, Art. This made my butt pucker too. This is truly a terrifying ghost story. He finally brought it back to ghosts.
I know. I wish that he would have actually been like, no, I don't know what you mean by puckering. Please explain. I need
How
to
many
know.
Clocks does this guy have too? Is it clocks are rolling around? I'm like, all right.
Well, he's a clock enthusiast. He's got a collection. Who knows?
Art always goes to the butt puckering thing. This isn't the first time he's used no, theories like
you're
that
right.
before, right?
I think I see you're looking for it.
I guess I haven't been paying attention to his sphincter speech.
That whole clip, it was loaded with potential soundboard clips. Play soundboard 10, because, you know, I love when people do sound effects, and especially if Art Bell's going to do them.
Really? Just like a window?
It's very Dogman-esque in here with those. I love that. And there's so many. Play soundboard 11, because this could be a fun reaction one.
That was a very puckering experience, if you know what I mean.
I know what you mean.
Definitely knows. And so, of course, soundboard 12, of course, I had to have Art Bell saying,
well, this has been sphincter tightening enough for me.
God, yo. Thankfully it wasn't the other way around, because it could have gotten real messy.
Wait,
sphincter loosening?
I was like, sphincter tightening for the other guy?
Sphincter tightening isn't a thing either. Nobody says that. That's insane.
He just said it about ghost stories. This is a scary ghost story. This is ghost to ghost. You got Nazis and perverts and all kind of weirdos on here. My sphincter's tightening just having to do this research.
Night and night, keep your butthole tight.
Look, last week my hair went white. Now my sphincter's all tightened up. This is not a good week for Rod Champ. I'm not liking this.
You're going to need some relaxers.
I really have to relax, but I can't during Spooktober. We have one final ghost-to-ghost caller for this evening, and we got to do this again sometime, because there are so many of these ghost-to-ghost AM episodes. We haven't even scratched the surface.
But before
we hear the final caller, I have an important PSA from Art Bell about airplanes.
I have a very good friend that works for one of the major airlines in this country, maybe the biggest airline, actually. And there are some planes, and I'm intentionally not going to tell you which airline it is. Actually, they've made movies about it. But because of the violent nature of airplane crashes, companies that have been in the business for a very long time and have had crashes, no, planes are haunted. There are some bone-chilling stories to be told about haunted airplanes. And because I don't want to compromise something that's been told to me, I'm not going to pass it on to you. I'm just going to say, believe it. There are some airplanes that are that have more flying than just the paying passengers. Let me put it that way.
Okay, this seems like a bigger problem than any of us knew, right? There are so many haunted planes, and the airlines, they are well aware of this situation. How are planes being haunted, Dre?
Oh, man.
Spare parts from crashes? What is it?
That is the only thing that my brain went to, yes. It's like, all right, I can see part of it being salvaged. Okay, this piece of metal has some residual energy to it. That's kind of crazy. I can see it happening maybe once or twice, but I mean, typically, shit, if people are dying in an air crash, that plane's probably...
Well, people died in midair. Hold on, Dre, I have a question, a serious one.
Oh, shit, good point.
If people die in midair, is there ghosts haunting midair, and they can just catch planes randomly if it's happened to be in the jet stream?
Yes, the ethereal residue, it just kind of lingers in like the stratosphere, and so they could become...
So there's
rain.
Moon ghosts, there's space ghosts, there's sky ghosts, there's sky
oh,
fish.
Oh, man. No, that's actually a really interesting question. I've never thought about that. But
well, Art Bell makes airplane ghosts seem very serious. And I flew very recently, and I did not think about ghosts, and I should have.
Didn't it's even cross my mind
It's the last
once.
Thing you should worry about when you're on a fucking plane is a ghost.
Or is it, though? Or is it? You know what I mean?
I'm going to say
I'm
too.
Just worried about the bathroom being free if I need to pee. That's my biggest concern.
I know. I see it didn't get clipped, but I do love Art Bell, which is the general phrase of airplanes are haunted. Just like all airplanes are haunted.
Planes are haunted.
You know, it's a general fact. Airplanes, they're haunted.
It's an industry insider secret. They all know this is happening. But now that we are aware of the supernatural threat facing us in air travel, let's listen to a final ghost-to-ghost story from Birmingham, Alabama. We got some Alabama strangeness to close this out. It's a man named Alan.
So, me and my best friend Lance, it's like, you know, we always kind of have like sort of like the same dreams and stuff, but we was always wondering how this happened and stuff. So, one night, about 3 o'clock in the morning, all these dogs in the neighborhood started barking, and, you know, we was wondering what was going on. So we walked outside and looked around and couldn't see nothing. Also, we looked up in this tree and there was these red glowing eyes. It was real freaky.
Red glowing eyes?
Yeah. Okay. And about that time, the dog shut up and the whole neighborhood went black. We come found out the next day all Southeast Huntsville was in a blackout. And all of a sudden there was this white Bengal tiger, it was like a shadow, walked up in the yard.
Yes.
And all of a sudden, it transformed, and this man, he was Egyptian.
What? Okay, wait, hold on.
What?
This sounded like a very much like a Mothman sighting in the 90s. This guy started sounding incredible. I don't know why Alabama man would lie about this, but all of a sudden, we had a Bengal tiger, and how do you know when the guy was Egyptian? I have a lot of questions.
I mean, is it so confusing why an Egyptian would be with a Bengal tiger?
Just imagine, you're hanging out, and all of a sudden, your dog starts barking like,
what?
And you're like, what the fuck? It's a Bengal tiger. At first, you see red eyes in a tree, and that I thought it was a banshee for a second, or like
I was thinking Mothman. Though I was just thinking like it's a very Mothmanish, and then it's like when it came down, and how do you know he was an Egyptian? Also, is his superpower like race identification? That yeah,
maybe maybe he meant like an Egyptian, like when we think of ancient Egypt, and had like the whole headdress and the
like
eyeliner.
It turned into like
all right. I think Dre is on the right trail here. Because you two want to hear more about an Egyptian Mothman in Alabama?
Yes, please.
Okay.
Okey.
He was Egyptian. And he said his name was Ptolemy, which I found out there was a real, he was an Egyptian astrologer and mathematician named Ptolemy who lived back in 300 AD or something like that. And he told us that what he was, who he was, and everything, and that things like this would happen, and sooner or later he would tell us why and show us why. And ever since then, we like have dreams about him and everything, and it's real weird.
Okay.
Yes. So
yeah, it is
Ptolemy. Ptolemy, he was a pharaoh. Yeah, maybe that's why he knew he's an Egyptian. Dre was on the right track. He was definitely dressed like a pharaoh, easily identifiable as Egyptian. So he's a historical figure. This is a general. He was a historian. Ptolemy was one of the companions of Alexander the Great. And in the 1990s, he was visiting these two guys in Alabama in their dreams. I'm sold. I love this.
And they're just like, it's a dang old Egyptian over there. Look at that. Like, what the, I love this.
Came
guy
off the tree like a Bengal tiger. I thought it was a Mothman.
And you know, and everything like that. Like, okay. Yeah, I guess I get what you're saying.
The story has taken so many turns. I'm just like imagining Bill and Ted at this point. Like, sure, why not? Historical figures bring all kinds of zoo animals. For what purpose? Like, did he say, like, did they get anything important and any kind of message?
Oh, they did. Let's hear the wrap-up to the Ptolemy Mothman of Alabama ghost story.
Real weird, because we'll, like, be dreaming.
So, in other words, he's never really left you.
Right. It's like he said he'd be there to protect us and things like that. And Lance has had occurrences where he's protected him while he's been in Germany and everything. But one of the strangest ones was last Christmas he was at home. Me and him was out sitting in the living room and was going to leave and go outside down to his parents' house. And what happened is I went to open the door, and as soon as I opened the door, it's like both me and him went flying back into the middle of the living room. The door shut, and about 20 seconds later, a car came by with a drive-by shooting.
Oh, well, that's quite a story.
Yeah.
Look, yeah. Ptolemy is a real one. He, like, actually cares for these dudes. He's always checking up on them. He warns them of drive-bys. He's pushed them out of the way. Man, respect.
He just loves these guys. I don't know if he was watching them for a while, and it's like, these guys, I like their vibe. I'm just going to look out for them.
I'll count it as a ghost story. It's a ghost story, huh?
Yeah. Sure. I guess he's like a harbinger. What are they called? Like,
a harbinger?
Harbinger. A harbinger.
Just for,
you know,
these two dudes in Alabama, they get to have this great ancient Egyptian historian and pharaoh and like big time figure. But he just looks out for he's just like in with them.
You know what would be really cool is if he was kind of Mothman like and he kind of went around in this whole town helping out all the townspeople and being like, don't trip over that. Yeah.
Everybody needs
this guy.
Someone needs to channel Ptolemy. What's he doing? Does anyone even care about him? People worry about Saint Germain and all these other ones.
I do now. Now that I know he's out there, like, I'm going to pray to him and be like, could you please, I don't know, keep me from getting bitten by spiders. I don't know. I don't really get in dangerous situations very often. I don't have people looking to shoot me.
Well, I was going to say, just Ptolemy, if you could show up in poll results, would be kind of funny. Just kind of give us advice. That'd be fun.
And the Bengal tiger aspect of it, really, it's like it comes and goes so quickly. Like, they don't really ever mention it again. It's just like, yeah, also, he was a Bengal tiger.
I did forget about that.
That's how Mothman gets out of the tree. He has to be a tiger because they can, you know,
white
go down the tree real quick.
A white Bengal tiger. Is this like, we're talking Tiger King? This is like Joe Exotic level.
This is ghost. We're staying with ghosts. And we've come to the end. We have come to the end of this Art Bell spooktacular extravaganza. I gotta ask, you have any final thoughts on any of this, Drea?
What a roller coaster. I legit got a little spooked out at some of the stories, just imagining, like, if that happened to me. That last story sounded pretty cool. If that happened to me, I wouldn't be scared until he, like,
one. It really is.
Yeah, if he shoves you back in your house to avoid that, like, couldn't you have just, like, distracted me with something else? Like, oh, I can't tie my shoelaces for some reason.
No, instead of pushing me over. Yeah, he's pushing you down.
But this was great. It was loaded.
It is. And that's what I'm saying. This is just the 1993 Ghost to Ghost. There's so much of this. There's decades of this. We have to do more at some point.
That's amazing.
What do you think, Rob? What do you think of Ghost to Ghost?
Art Bell's listeners never disappoint. And those call-ins, I feel like, doesn't even matter what they're calling about half the time. Like, today, sometimes people just call and they're just like, people get real creeped out because I'm a Nazi. Like, obviously.
There was so much.
And well, like, I got a new bedroom set furniture.
I'm sorry if this went a little long. Like, there was even stuff we cut out. Like, we will do a Patreon. I have a couple of Patreon bits.
Oh, yay.
Yeah. Go to patreon.com. There's just too much for this. But what should this week's poll be? I think it should be, which caller was the scariest? What do you think about that?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's perfect.
Yeah, okay. So go to unbelieverspodcast.com. Go answer this week's poll. Which caller was the scariest? Was it the child regression girlfriend? Was it the Nazi? Was it Ptolemy Mothman? Was it Dirty Harry Ouija or other? And that's it. Let's get out of here. What a weird episode of Art Bell to talk about. These guys are all over the place. It's so hard to nail down even any ghost stories. Everyone wanted to had something really disturbing to say.
Yeah.
Yeah, Hitler.
To say the least.
It was a nice grab bag, you know? It's like, I don't know. That felt very Halloween, you know? You get a lot of silly, with the spooky stuff. So, I mean, it was great. It was fine.
That's a great part of Halloween, though. Everyone wants to get in the spirit, even if they don't have a story of spirits at all. They'll somehow, whatever they're into is very eerie or weird, even if it's Hitler or regressed children of your girlfriend.
I'm just trying to figure out why Art Bell even gave that guy any sort of a platform. If he knew that he was like a Nazi from beforehand.
Right. Oh, yeah, he could have cut him.
You could be
off.
Talking about anyone. I didn't know you were even talking about the Nazi. I was like, that could have been any one of these people. And I'm like, yeah, I don't know why either, but that's why I had to play.
You were just thinking, at a certain point, he'd be like, oh, yeah, let's not play the Nazi guy anymore. But I guess, you know what? Whatever.
Oh, Pavo, Canada. Hey, what's up, Pavo, my boy? Like, whoa.
Well, maybe that would inspire other people to call in and be like, fuck that Nazi. I've got a real ghost story. Like, oh, this is who I'm contending with.
Yeah, you know? Nothing to do with ghosts at all. Nah. This guy is just out here talking about
eerie.
Of course people feel uncomfortable when they deal with you because you talk like a creep and you live in a Nazi museum.
And that's what Spooktober is all about. Being very uncomfortable, very eerie and weird, Spooktober. And so we're going to move on. We got a great little email that I want to read. Let's go to the Unbelievers mailbag.
The Unbelievers mailbag.
Ooh, right in the mailbag.
Hey, man, check your mailbag.
Hey, you got some new mail over here.
Mailbag. The mailbag is cool. Mailbag.
Sup, bitches. It's mail time.
So, Drea, you are a former holder of the wand, correct?
Yes, that's correct.
And Rob, you are a former holder of this fucking wand, the P.P. Warren wand, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I am as well. That thing has been around. That thing has made the rounds to a lot of different people. We talked about it last week. We had Michelle on. We did a great wand update. And we put a call out. We said, if you want to be the next one to possess the wand, to reach out. And we had a few people reach out. There is one email I want to read, and this comes from, let's hear it. Here's the email. It says, hey, guys, Green Finhawk here. They also call me Jeremy. I would love to have that wand in my possession. I'm starting a new creative painting company where I paint murals on buildings and inside clients' homes and businesses.
Oh, no.
I also have an altar of my crystals I have been collecting for the past 20 years. And I can definitely add something cool to that fucking wand. Please let me know what you guys think. Thank you. Signed, Green Finhawk. And I'm going to say, Green Finhawk, we had a few people reach out, but Green Finhawk is kind of checking all the boxes here. He's into crystals. He's definitely a big-time unbeliever. We know you, Green Finhawk. You've been around. What do you think of that, Drea?
The only reason I said, oh, no, is because that story we just had of the guy and his murals and shrines to Hitler. So I hear murals and altars again.
Oh, wait. No, place soundboard 9. Wait, is he going to take this wand and use it for?
To you know who?
Hitler.
Yes. No.
Yeah, no, this guy. Yeah, no.
Green Finhawk.
This is different mural. Hold on. He's painting nice murals. He's not painting Hitler all around wherever he is.
It just reminded me, and it was a visceral reaction. I apologize. I think he'd be a great recipient for the wand.
I think so too. Yeah.
I do too. I think Green Finhawk, I think you and Mish need to connect, and I know you guys can figure it out, or we'll get it connected. I'm going to say, great application for getting this fucking wand, the P.P. Warren wand, and you're going to have it. Put it on your altar.
I just had an idea also of something I think that I'm going to do as soon as we finish recording. On our Discord, I'm going to create a new subcategory on there called the wand, so that we can, if anybody wants to talk about the wand, we can maybe figure out ways to exchange the wand. We can do it in there. Go join the Discord and
we'll pass
check out
along
the wand
festival,
categories.
The wand channel,
the wand
through
channel,
the mail.
Exactly.
Oh, there's a live wand channel. Anyone who has it has to do a weekly live thread where they talk about the wand. We ask questions.
Extra responsibilities now. Yeah,
this sounds great.
Unbelievers, you can get all your wishes will come true with this Joshua P. Warren wand that we have empowered with our positivity and our negativity, maybe.
Yeah,
I don't think I even said negativity, right? That's a negativity. I don't know what I'm talking about. So Green Finhawk and Mish get together, and this wand is going to move on, and we're going to have him on. And that's it for this week's Unbelievers Mailbag.
The Unbelievers Mailbag.
Ooh, right in the mailbag.
Hey, man, check your mailbox.
Hey, you got some new mail over here.
Mailbag. 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 The mailbag is mailbag. Cool. Mailbag.
Sup, bitches. It's mail time. Woo! 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 Woo!
So, Drea, Rob, when we get to the end of the show, there's a segment we like to do. Now, this segment is going to be a little different this week, and I want to explain. So every week, we do our poll results, and our poll results are always through unbelieverspodcast.com. We have had a little technical difficulty this week. In the beginning of the week, the poll did not work, so I put it out there on Facebook and Twitter. I think Rob threw it up on Instagram. Mm-hmm. Hey, the website is not working, so let's just do a random poll result. And somehow the website started working later in the week, and now there's poll results coming from everywhere. So, Drea, what's the next thing we're doing?
I mean, I guess it's going to be poll results.
Oh, boy.
This is going to be crazy.
Yes, this week's poll, what's the spookiest thing in the woods? And the choices were, let's see, the choices were, we had Bigfoot, we had creepy uncles, man-sized holes, dead granny ghosts, ants, and of course, other. And this is on multiple fronts. I have to look at this on our website, on Facebook, and other things. I'm going to ask you, Drea Mora, what do you think the unbelievers said?
I'm going to go with creepy uncles.
All right. Drea's going with creepy uncles. How about you, Rob? What do you think the unbelievers voted for?
You know, I can't get enough of those man-sized holes.
All right. Well, this was definitely a toss-up because through the regular polls, everyone picked another. So I don't have to worry about that. There's nothing. Everyone through the proper channels. And I will say, on Facebook, Creepy Uncles comes in on top. But
okay,
on Twitter, man-sized holes with 74% of the vote. A lot of people.
It's interesting how the different areas, the different groups are going to vote a different way. This is interesting.
This is very interesting. And I guess congratulations to both of you. But of course, there are others. What's the spookiest thing in the woods? My creepy uncle, he used to dress up in a Bigfoot costume and jerk off meat on a tree. Signed, Voodoo. Okay, thank you, Voodoo. Your creepy uncle is in a Bigfoot. He's jerking off.
Jerked off a piece of meat.
Yes, I do.
Thank you, Voodoo. What's the creepiest thing in the woods? Me, half man, half chicken, half ugly motherfucker. Signed, half bad at math, man thing. Thank you, half bad at math, man thing. God damn. Great name. Thanks. And we got this for you.
Guess that makes him part human, part chicken.
Or the Baron Davis, whatever you want. Thank you, half bad at math man thing. What's the creepiest thing in the woods? Large cats. They hide in trees, sound like children screaming, and they will eat your face off. Signed, the third Daniel. They are very scary. Thank you, third Daniel.
True. Yeah.
What's the creepiest thing in the woods? For those of you who think I've got the latest, greatest intel, I'll stop you right there. It's just a man-sized hole. Signed, Blue Box UFO. Oh, that I like that one. That was really good. Because you get Wilcox.
This is the latest, greatest intel.
And you get a host.
For those haters out there who think this is fake, I'll stop you right there.
And we got a new classic, Blue Box UFO, bringing up Jack's favorite, right?
And there's a man-sized hole in the nest.
Thank you, Blue Box UFO.
Jack and Rob's favorite.
What's the like scariest holes. Thing in the woods? Other than me, I'd say the weird guy playing with his meat in his tent, barking like a dog. Barking like a dog. Arf, arf, woof, woof. Signed, Man Bear Pig. All right, he likes the new guy. I love the dog sound guy. Play the other one. There's two of them. They're both great.
Woof, woof.
Oh, thank you, Man Bear Pig. What's the creepiest thing in the woods? I just purchased a microwave from Brown Mountain. That microwave didn't wave shit. Signed, Boner Yogurt. Thank you, Boner Yogurt.
Okay.
I don't understand it, but I like it.
I like it. What's the creepiest thing in the woods? Last I was in the woods, I hit Freddy with a tree branch. Now I am Pants Filler.
Nice. Yep.
Yeah, Pants Filler getting his own name in there. Now I am
be throwing up and
filling my pants.
Thank you, pants filler.
That's what happens.
Rest in peace to, what was the dog's name?
Susie. Rest in peace, Susie.
Poor
Susie.
Love Susie.
What's the spookiest thing in the woods? They call that Uncle the Bushman. He'll make a man-sized hole in that nest. Signed, the Wombat Preservationist. Oh, the Bushman. If I saw him, I'd be like,
hell yeah, Bushman.
Bushman.
Right,
Bushman.
We are.
No. I would do that too, of course.
Yeah, you would.
But I would definitely say,
Rabba-dabba-doo, Bushman.
Yeah.
Right, thank you, Wombat Preservationist. What's the spookiest thing in the woods? Bigfoot smegma ridden dick. Signed, Destin Star.
Agreed.
Okay, thank you, Destin Star. What's the spookiest thing in the woods? Why does everything on this podcast have to be a callback? Ring, 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 ring. 1, 2, 3, 4, 97, 98, 99, 100. Signed, Radimus. Oh, that's very clever, Radimus. Callbacks, and it keeps calling. I don't have those numbers, but I do have this.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17.
17. Thank you, Radimus. And okay, so now I have to shift. Those were the poll results from the actual website. Now, for some reason, we put this on Facebook, and now I don't know. Like I said, the poll started working again, but people had already come into Facebook. So now we get from Facebook, what's the spookiest thing in the woods? Is this a real show from Spencer?
I got to play Jack. I got to play it. A real show.
Oh, go
he
for
wants
it.
The real show.
Is this a real show?
Yes.
Thank you so much, Spencer Paul. What's the spookiest thing in the woods? Jack's sultry, rugged voice gives my woods the terrors. And that's gay for one thing, and we don't do that. Signed, Unbeliever Braden. Uh-oh.
Oh, I love it.
Jack gets some love. I love it.
We don't get in bed with the reptilians, okay? It's gay for one thing. We don't do that.
Thank you, Unbeliever Braden.
He's catching your vibe, Russ. He knows what's going on there.
Oh, yeah.
And he's out there in the woods still, so.
What's the spookiest thing in the woods? I'd be pretty spooked if I saw a penguin in the woods. Signed, Virginia Veteran. Thank you, sure. Virginia Veteran. What's the spookiest thing in the woods? Rich Republicans naked next to redwood trees, right? Signed, Lid Vicious. That yes. might be the spookiest thing
that's,
in the woods.
That's beautiful. The top of the list for me. Here you go.
That's where all those rich Republicans go up and stand naked against redwood trees, right?
And look, just because you guys are voting, Lid got 5 laughy face emotes on Facebook for that.
Ooh,
people loving Lid Vicious.
Well, add mine to it. I intentionally didn't look at that post, so.
What's the spookiest thing in the woods? It could be monkeys or vicious tigers. Signed, no sign off. Uh-oh.
That's good, too.
That's really great.
They could be vicious monkeys or could be tigers.
Monkeys. Thank you, no sign off. What's the spookiest thing in the woods? Maybe the man-sized hole was actually a ghost-sized hole. Poor uncle getting blamed for all the weird things this ghost gets up to. Signed, Mothman Mother. Mothman Mother making her way, winning last week, and coming through on Facebook, too, here. Very good.
And there's a man-sized hole in the nest.
Of course. Thank you. What's the spookiest thing in the woods? A busted bladder.
Yeah.
Signed, Pamsy. Pamsy dropping the one. She knows what butter means.
Anywhere in the woods.
Patreon. Patreon content right there. Here you go.
My bladder is busted, man. I gotta go to bed.
Thank you,
I forgot
Pamsy.
That was Patreon. Yeah. Yep.
Of course. Thank you, Pamsy. What's the spookiest thing in the woods? About that hole. Last night, I saw an uncle on the roof observing us. Signed, Hospitable Millennial. Thank you, Hospitable Millennial.
God. Given the new... About that hole?
Yeah, but I want the new roof one because now we have...
A grade
on our roof.
Observing us.
Thank you, Hospitable Millennial. What's the spookiest thing in the woods? Man, some of these get long because they can put it on Facebook. So this is a little bit of a longer one. The scariest thing in the woods is those two arslers. Imagine, if you will, a crisp fall day. You head out hunting and have a great day. Two deer, a goose, and a gray on the roof, no longer observing us. You come back to the cabin to crawl in your man-sized hole, only to be axed by two drunk idiots who can't afford a hotel or a full-size spare. Signed, Hose B! Thank you, Hose B. Hose B really got to go off on Facebook. This is a one-time thing. We're not doing this again. Thank you, Hose B. What's the spookiest thing in the woods? I don't understand what brought me here. Maybe it was my creepy uncle. It was really painful. Jesus.
Oh,
Harley
no.
Warren. Thank you, Harley Warren. Very good.
I had to bring it back.
Here
to
you
the
go.
Dirty.
I don't understand what brought me here.
Thank you, Harley Warren. Very timely. What's the spookiest thing in the woods? Catching Jack in the act, learning why he has no sleeves on his t-shirt. Signed. I'll just say, you didn't sign off, but I know that you, the machinist. Catching Jack in the act, learning why he
has
no sleeves
on his t-shirt. That's a reference. That's a Spirits and Spirits reference.
Yes, that's a Spirits and Spirits reference. Thank you, machinist. What's the spookiest thing in the woods? Oh, yeah, right. Like, I'm going to use my alias in public. Get real. Sign Sharky Christmas, Sharky Xmas, Shorky Christmas. All of those things. I really want to say his real name. I won't. Thank you, Sharky. What's the spookiest thing in the woods? The final one for Facebook. I've seen Russell Ryan sport a romper in a cabin in the woods. Nothing scares me anymore. Signed, Jack Sassabarilla.
Oh, yeah, well, I think I know who that is.
If you've seen me in a romper in the woods, you'd probably be like...
In fact, Russell Ryan's on here saying, yeah, ask women.
Thank you, Jack Sassabarilla. That's what it was for. I wish we were done. We are not, because also this is on Twitter where Man Size Holds One. There's just a couple from Twitter. Boner Yogurt, you did yours twice. We had this one. What's the spookiest thing in the woods? I don't know the question just yet, but I imagine the answer is still something to do with the missing cinnamon toast shrimp guy. Signed at If I Fell. Thanks at If I Fell. And we had finally for this evening.
We still have
what's
Instagram.
The spookiest thing? What's the spookiest thing? Oh, wait, we still have Instagram too. Jesus Christ. What's the spookiest thing in the woods? Finally, from Twitter, we had Unbeliever Carol with Rob's wife. That's you're in the lead. You're in the lead. The spookiest thing in the woods being Rob's
right.
wife. Damn so, it. Rob, you have to finish this. So, what is the Instagram poll? This is so long.
All right, we'll keep it going here. We'll just keep it rolling. Corrupted Mask hit us with a ghost with very large straight-on hard-on. Oh, wait. That's the spookiest thing with wood. Never mind.
Right.
Okay.
He's
so
always
I think...
bringing the clip back. He loves his straight-on hard-ons. We know Corrupted Mask. Thank you for reminding us. Play it for him. Give him a straight-on hard-on.
A very large straight-on hard-on.
The sound effect always gets me.
And then that was great. And then we had someone who said, Mel's Hole. This is from B.C. Sores. She just said, Mel's Hole is the scariest thing in the woods.
Mel's
so.
Man's
okay,
hole,
Mel's
yeah.
Hole is the spookiest thing in the woods. What else we got?
I mean, I guess if she's mentioning Mel's Hole, though, she's kind of like...
Yeah, about that hole.
You know. Then we'll keep it moving here. We had Shut Up Aaron says... Afraid of my dad guy's dad, but what do I know? I'll just shut up now.
Wow. If she could usurp scared of my dad guy, because he didn't chime in this week yet. Oh, that would be great. You're in the lead for me.
That's
if scared of my dad guy finally wins because Shut Up Aaron posted about him. Okay, go on. What else you got?
Kosher Leviathan, a.k.a. Peeking Bigfoot, said, I'm frightened of people that come to the woods. I try to hide behind bushes. So I think we all know who he's referring to there. I think
this is weird hearing you read poll results. What's going on? You gotta hurry.
This is really it is.
I know it's so funny.
I mean, this is a little different. This
I
week.
Love it. I love it.
Here we go.
Do you have any
here
more?
Here is Sasquatch peeking out from behind a bush.
And then we have one last one here.
All right, the final one for this evening. Our final. What is the spookiest thing in the woods?
This is from Cool Parents Worldwide, and they just said the Whisker Man.
What?
Okay,
I don't know.
Thank you.
I don't know who he is.
Listen
but
to some cool parents
so
in the
much.
Woods.
Wow. So many great ones this week. I'm going to try to do the recap in a manic way. So, oh man, so many great ones. What is the spookiest thing in the woods? We had voodooed with my creepy uncle who used to dress up in Bigfoot's costume and jerk off meat on a tree. We had half bad at math man thing with me, half man, half chicken, half ugly motherfucker. We had the third Daniel with Lord Cats. They hide in trees, sound like children screaming, and they will eat your face off. We had Blue Box UFO with, for those of you who think I've got the latest greatest intel, I'll stop you right there. It's just a man-sized hole. We had Man Bear Pig with, other than me, I'd say the weird guy playing with his meat in his tent, barking like a dog. dog, arf, arf, woof, woof. We had boner yogurt with, I just purchased a microwave from Brown Mountain. The microwave didn't wave shit. We had pants filler with, last I was in the woods, I hit Freddy with a tree branch. Now I am. We had the wombat preservationist with, they call that uncle the bushman. He'll make a man-sized hole in that nest. We had Destin Star with Bigfoot's smegma-ridden dick. We had Radimus with, why does everything on this podcast have to be a callback? Ring, 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 ring. 1, 2, 3, 4, 97, 98, 99, 100. We had, oh my God, now I have to move on. We had Spencer Paul with, is this a real show? We had Unbeliever Braden with Jack's sultry rugged voice gives my woods the terrors, and that's gay for one thing. We don't do that. We had Virginia Veteran with, I'd be pretty spooked if I saw a penguin in the woods. We had Lid Vicious with, rich Republicans next to redwood trees, right? We had No Sign Off with, it could be monkeys or vicious tigers. We had Mothman Mother, maybe the man-sized hole was actually a ghost-sized hole. Poor uncle getting blamed for all the weird things the ghost gets up to. We had Pamsy with a busted bladder. We had Hospitable Millennial with, about that hole, last night I saw an uncle in a roof observing us. We had a really long one from Hose B. Jesus, scary thing in the woods is 2 R words. Imagine if you will, a crisp fall day, you head out hunting and you have a great day, 2 deer, a goose, and all kind of stuff. We had Harley Warren with, I don't understand what brought me here. Maybe it was my creepy uncle. It was really painful. We had the Machinist with catching Jack in the act, learning why he has no sleeves on his t-shirt. We had Sharky Axioms with, oh yeah, right, like I'm going to use my alias in public, get real. We had Jack Sarsaparilla with, I've seen Russell Ryan sport a romper in a cabin in the woods. Nothing scares me anymore. We had Unbeliever Carol with, Rob's wife. We had at If I Fell with, I don't know the question just yet, but I imagine the answer is still something to do with the missing cinnamon toast shrimp guy. And Rob, come on, you got a couple to finish them out. What do you got?
Corrupted Mask hit us with a ghost with a very large straight on hard on. Oh, wait, Jesus. That's the spookiest thing with wood.
Don't
never
hit me
mind
with that.
We had Mel's Hole from VC Soares. We had Shut Up Aaron with Afraid of My Dad Guy's Dad, but what do I know? I'll just shut up now. We had Kosher Leviathan, a.k.a. Peeking Bigfoot. I'm afraid of people that come to the woods. I try to hide behind bushes. And then finally, we had Cool Parents Worldwide with The Whisker Man.
Okay. So many great ones tonight. As always, even more so, I don't even know if we should do this more or never do this again. This was fun, though, getting all of you guys in on this. But I'm going to ask you, Drea Mora, who do you think won this week's poll?
Jesus Christ. Oh, God. So I loved all of the Jack references for sure. I loved the Rob's wife entry. But I think I'm going to have to go with actually the Bohemian Grove from Lid Vicious.
Lid Vicious was pretty good. How about you, Rob? Who do you like?
Yeah, I have to agree. She was at the top of my list, and there were some really funny ones. I love the vicious monkeys. Seriously. And tigers, because I was like, I didn't even think of that. That is perfect.
That one is pretty good.
But there was
too.
No, they didn't
too
get a sign
many good
off,
ones.
So, yeah,
God.
But
honestly,
I gotta agree. Yeah.
Honestly, you know, it's always controversial when I just overvote y'all, and I'm going to do it again.
That's
so
fine.
I'm going to say, I don't know, I have to give it to Shut Up Aaron on Instagram. Shut Up Aaron with Read Hers Again, Rob, because that's the one I don't have in front of me, but I know it was my favorite one.
Afraid of really my great. Dad guy's dad, but what do I know? I'll just shut up now.
Thank you, Aaron, for shutting up, but also congratulations, Shut Up Aaron, with that and usurping Scared of My Dad Guy. You just won this week's a poll results. Wow, what an amazing Spooktober episode. We've come to the end of the program, but before we go, Drea Mora, do you have anything you'd like to say or plug?
Yeah, you can follow me on Instagram at @bestdreamora and at Spirits and Spirits Pod. And just as a little by note, Snacking with Jackpot is coming out very soon. So that should be out soon. And I just go and follow him on Instagram. It should be called at Snacking with Jackpot.
Excellent. And how about you, Rob? You anything to say or plug?
Just check out my Instagram, like usual, at Rob Okey, at Okey Audio. And one of the projects I'm working on over at LPN has their second season coming out, No Dogs in Space. So if you like music podcasts, check out No Dogs in Space.
Nice.
Yeah. We always like to support these lesser-known shows like Last Podcast on the Left and Abe Lincoln's Top Hat.
If you want to support your boy,
you know what I mean? You know, we try to look out for the up and comers in this. So we can straight up plug.
I'm just throwing it
and
out. I'm just there. Gonna say, just throwing it out there, you know.
Yeah, and I don't know. I'm Bizarro Russ on things, Instagram or something. That's it. The Unbelievers podcast host today were Drea Mora and me, Rus Ryan. Our producer and soundboard engineer is Rob Okey. You can go get our tarot cards at unbelievablepodcards.com. You can join our Patreon by going to patreon.com/unbelieverspodcast. We've got 2 great new episodes up there. The Mothman Prophecies movie commentary and the Tournament of SOS is still rolling on. We're at the semifinals. Very exciting. You can follow the show on Twitter at Unbelievers Pod and Instagram at Unbelievers Podcast. Our Facebook group is the Unbelievable Podcast Network. And check out our merch store at TeePublic. The link is in the description. There's always great stuff there. And thank you so much to our patrons, the Ominous Clouds, Chris Porteous, Richard Farrington, Robert Farrington, not Richard. Sorry, Robert. Sorry, Robert Farrington. Kyle Wilson, Dominic Sheely, Lid Vicious, Linnea Sirte, Fabian, Art Muffin, Nick Marshall, Ramiro, Sam Schvobel, Creepy Little Book, Johnny Knott, Sandy, and Deborah Foles, Cade Bote, Chris Stroker, Jeffrey Hartsonoff, Luis Payon, 8-Bit Melody, Jenny Dyer, Christopher Balderama, David Egelhoff, Pam Z, JG Spranklin, Vic Voss, Little BB, Dr. Ortega, Tyler Ventura, Adam Dvorak, Corrupted Mass, Michael Phillips, Carol Valley, Manny, MQ Ultra, CJP, Braden Hit, Raymond Orwell, Todd X, Christopher Panici, The Moon, Mike Henry, Bryce Gunnerberg Jr., Don Bright, Shannon Frigno, Tom O'Connell, Donna Banch, Jenna Stevens, Cat Chaos, Jason Kelly, Mike, Brian Ashton, Michael Arbenta, Wombat Preservationist. Our music advisor is Pandora 3373. Our official composer and theme song creator is Unbeliever Aaron, a.k.a. Aaron Schilb. Go follow him on Instagram at The Aaron Schilb. Our official graphic designer and card maker who designed our logo and also all our great Art Bell artwork that you have seen this week, which you guys haven't seen, but you're going to see an Art Bell Slimer that he has made for this episode, which looks great. Thank you so much, Raymond Orwell. Check out his work at PRavenCreative on Twitter and Project Raven Creative on Instagram. Our official Unbeliever listening between the stations for a message from Art Bell is Scott E. You got your message tonight, Scott E. Our official Hazmat Lou is Hazmat Lou. Our official Unbeliever without a title is Nicholas Aristavi. Our official Unbeliever raising puck wedges is Joe Filler. Our official Big Island paranormal friendly weatherman is Green Finhawk, the future holder of the wand, it seems. Our official resident Sagittarius is Gozanton. Our official madman is Unbeliever Adam. Our official Mothman and enthusiast is Michael Shields. Our official Unbelievers MUFON Inside Man is Kristen Moraes. Our official Unbeliever peacefully eating a hamburger and holding a wand is Michelle Durham. Our official Unbelievers time traveler is Taylor Nelson. Our official ghost hunter is Amelia Childs. And ghost hunting in New England. And what else, Drea?
Hubie Halloween.
On Netflix. Our official senior European correspondent is Kay Mill of the I Don't Know podcast. Our official guarding the bench is at Kraken Stacker. Our official alien bopper is Nunchuck Bob. And this week's Unbeliever Focus is Robert Farrington. Got it right this time. Who has been doing some experimenting with psionics. Mm. Look, Robert, he was recently testing out that intention prayer board thing from Tom Vrilock. Remember the psionic super asshole?
Yeah.
You know,
oh, yeah.
Of course.
The thing you have to take a shit on, you get back at your politicians or whatever.
Of course.
Yes.
So when I asked what politician he was focusing his negative shit intention to, he said...
To you know who?
Hitler.
Yes.
Good night, shower rubs.
Hitler.
Discontinue! Discontinue!